Hello, everybody. And I gotta say, it is so good to be back doing this. We are the Wizard and the Kid Elton John album review show. We have not done an episode in 2.5 years. I mean, it's so great. I'm so excited to do this. I decided to show up right on time. You know, I'm not back there trying to figure out what I'm wearing or figure out what to do. You know, I decided to show up right on time, sit right at the desk here, and start talking to my wonderful co-host, Mr. Stan the Kid. How are you doing today?
I mean, I'm doing quite well. It's good to see your... Well, I mean, it was good to talk to you until you flipped the camera on, but... Yeah, we're doing this again.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we haven't really conversed in such a long time. You know, I was so excited to see you, I decided to learn a phrase of Dutch just for you.
And I'm sure you're horrible at it. Let's hear it then.
You know what? I respectfully disagree. I've been going over this for about 15, 20 minutes before I decided to call you.
That's what caused that delay then.
Oh, something else. Not important.
Sure.
All right. So, Goedenavond.
That's it. Yes. It took you a whole 15 minutes to learn
yes.
that. Well, I mean, it was decent, I suppose. Oh, well.
Hey, you've heard a lot worse. Come on, you admit you've heard a lot worse coming out of my mouth.
Yeah, but I mean, that was the last time you spoke Dutch, so... If you hadn't improved over the two and a half years that we've not been doing this, I'd seriously be considering quitting this show.
Yeah, well, the thing is, what you have to understand, Stan, is the fact that I am a 30-year-old American male who is not very good at foreign language skills. I mean, it took me all of 30 years to properly learn English to get to where I am today. So, it takes a while.
Yeah, well, seeing the way you're dressed, languages is not the only thing you're bad at.
What? You know, I just decided to go into my closet, you know, because I knew I had to do this. But we're honoring Elton John here. I mean, this is Elton John.
Exactly. So why do you look like a Village People reject?
Well, because he told me to do that.
I'm pretty sure that he didn't.
Well, look. There's nothing wrong with wearing outfits like this, because this is my thinking cap. It allows me to think of things to say for the show. These glasses are hiding secrets. You don't want to know what's behind these glasses. And, you know, this is a very comfortable jacket.
It sure doesn't look like it.
It is very comfortable. It's leather.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. Why you'd want to reminisce about leather jackets when we're finally heading into Elton's sober period is anybody's guess.
Well,
but
I listened to the album. I was listening to the album before we were doing the show, so I thought, hey, you know, got to pay tribute to that era while we talk about a different album. That's the way I work.
Yeah, that's the way you work. You decide that if we're going to review one specific album, while reviewing that album, you're going to pay homage to a completely different album.
I know it's different, but what you have to understand is I don't operate on the same frequencies as you or most other people. You know, I am very ill in a lot of areas, especially mentally. So I don't necessarily function the same as most normal human beings. I have my own way of doing things. But here's the thing. I'm happy with the way I do things. And I'm not really going to change that unless something so bad happens that I'll be forced to change my ways. Like, for example...
When you reviewed I Am Your Robot, like something like that. That was a catastrophe of immeasurable magnitude.
Well, Oh, I Am Your Robot. Oh, that song. Oh, that I've been trying to forget that, but apparently people don't want me to forget that, and they keep tagging my name, and they even know the timestamp. That's scary. They keep saying, "Hey, Greg, go to 2020 on this video," and I click on it, and it's that goddamn review on that goddamn song. And I mean, I still
you've simply branded yourself for life, my friend. You're never ever going to escape that. When you die on your gravestone, there's gonna say, "Here lies the only guy who liked 'I Am Your Robot' from Elton John's Jump Up album."
That's not true. That's not true. There's one other person that likes it more than me. He gives it 5 out of 5.
Who's this person exactly?
Well, here's the thing. I am telling you the exact truth. There is one person. He subscribed to my channel, and he's in the comment section, and he absolutely loves the song more than myself.
Well, I hope you'll be happy together.
Oh, absolutely. We're the only two people that actually like that song. But here's the thing. You know, music is a very, it's a fun art to talk about, but it's also very subjective. I mean, it's like, you know, there's a lot of people that give unnecessary hate on that song and a couple other songs in Elton's catalog. But, you know, a lot of that material is just, you know, grade A, you know, progressive, anthemic, amazing material. And it's an art. It's an art. It may not be for everybody, but it's art. So that's what it is.
You know what? It's been 2.5 years. I'm not going to waste my first rant on this. Why don't we just get started and get this over with?
You know what? Well, there's a couple things I got to address about that. One, I agree with you. It has been 2.5 years.
Yeah, I know.
And here's the thing. We owe it to our fan base that has been loyally following all those old episodes. We owe it to them to put on a show for them and to give our hearts to this upcoming album that we're going to review in just a few minutes.
Yeah, well, I'm all for it. I'm ready to go.
You know, I'm ready too. I mean, there's no debate. I am absolutely ready to go. I am so ready for this. How about you?
Then stop stalling and let's just get to it.
I'm not stalling. I'm simply explaining everything.
You're not explaining. You keep repeating the same phrase, "I am ready," all over. You're sounding like SpongeBob SquarePants.
Oh, don't make me break out my guitar and do the campfire song.
See, and now you're making more references, so you're still stalling.
I'm not stalling whatsoever. I'm just responding to things that you tell me.
Will you just get us started?
Yes. So, before we do that, we have to give a preview to this album. You know, we got to flash a nice little picture of the album covers, have a little preview, just so people know what they're getting themselves into, and then we will start. Fair? Do I have a handshake on that?
Fair. You're not having a handshake because you're in America, and I know what the coronavirus rules are like over there, so I'm not taking that risk, but I agree with you.
All right, well, I'll improvise. There.
Good for you.
Good for me, yeah.
Let's just get started, shall we? Here's the preview, everyone.
Okay. Well, since you're going like that, I'll do this.
Yeah. Too bad you've got nothing there, do you?
Yeah, because I fucking shaved for this review. You know, I had to make sure I looked my best, unlike you. I mean, come on. We have to look great for our audience.
I look well enough.
Well, I'm not denying that you're fine. I'm just saying you need to be on top of everything. Look at me.
I think you're the definition of not being on top of everything. Heck, you don't even have your notes ready today.
I have them ready. They're just not there physically.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Look, I don't need notes. You know, I don't need to have paper right there giving me the answers. Because you know why? I can just make up shit.
Well, know that if you make up shit, I will call you out on it.
All right. Well, you know what? Fair enough. You know, we'll operate from two different perspectives. And we'll do this review. So, is everything okay?
Just seeing you chug down that bottle explains so much of your behavior right now. Let's just get started, all right? Why don't you introduce the album?
Absolutely. Well, we're going to be reviewing Elton John's 23rd studio album, called The One. And it was released on June 22nd, 1992. And upon doing some quick research for this album, I was actually very surprised by the fact that it's the biggest selling album that he's done in the United States since 1975. You know, because I thought it was Too Low for Zero. But after, you know, going back and kind of going through things and looking up information, I'm very surprised that this sold more than Too Low for Zero and Breaking Hearts. And I'm like, well,
it's not surprising. If you think about it, this is the first album he released after having had a big hit with Sacrifice, mm-hmm. which was his first solo number one.
True.
In the UK, and was a hit all over the world. So that's probably a big motivator for people to finally buy his albums again.
Yeah, well, it was a hit over here. It reached number two in the United Kingdom, and it was kept off the top spot by a Lionel Richie compilation album. And over here, the album did very well. It was in the top 10, reached number 8. And in your neck of the woods, it didn't do too badly either. It was a top 20. I believe it was position 14 on the chart. So, I mean, overall, pretty successful. And even by the end of the year, it was still on the U.S. chart. So, I mean, yay. I mean, congrats, Elton. What can I say? You know, it's double platinum over here. I'm not sure about the sales in your neck of the woods, but I imagine they were quite respectable.
They were, and I must say, I'm sure that Elton is very pleased to receive that one round of applause by a Leather Jackets ripoff like you.
Oh, come on. You know, I'm just trying to pay tribute to Elton in any way that I can. Because here's the thing. I don't have the hair weave that he had during this era, and I certainly don't have those fantastic outfits, so this is the best I could come up with.
Yes, reminding him of the one album that he's been very vocal about that he doesn't like. I'm sure he's mighty pleased.
Well, it's got Paris on it, Slow Rivers and Angeline and the title track and all those classics. So there you
I'm
go.
I'm just gonna stop you there. Let's not delve into that album. Let's delve into The One.
Okay. Hey, thanks for keeping me on track. You know, sometimes when you're a tortured soul like myself, you can't stay on topic too well. But in any case, the album was a commercial success, putting it mildly. And there were four singles released from this album. And reviews were fairly favorable from the reviews I've been getting. So what we're going to do is we're going to review this album, and I'm very interested to know what you think of this, because We haven't done a show for 2.5 years. I haven't heard your lovely Dutch accent for so long. I was crying into my pillow yesterday. But, you know.
Sure you were.
No, I don't tell lies. But, you know, I'm interested to know what you think of this album because it's been such a long time, and I can't wait to discuss Elton John albums with you again.
Good.
And I'm being authentic.
Good. Then why don't you get us started with the first track of the album?
All right. Well, the first track is Simple Life. And it was released as the fourth single off the album. It was released in May of 93, I believe, as the fourth single. Opening off the album, I think it's a very, very strong song. Really good. I love the message that the song provides. I think it's a really strong song overall. I enjoy listening to it. I do prefer live renditions overall, just because I'm more used to them. But plus, I think the song comes off just better in the live environment, especially when it gets paired with the next song, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. But I think Simple Life is a great start to this album, and I'm, you know, so far I'm pleased with it. For a ranking, it's a strong song. I would say a solid 4 out of 5. I like it a lot, and I'm pleased with it in general. And despite the fact that it's about 6.5 minutes, I think it's one of those songs that it benefits from it, and it deserves the length. Like, it's structured very well for a 6.5 minute song. Like, there's nothing I would really say, oh, it drags on too long, or, you know, trim this or trim the fat. I think it's a good track that is worthy of that length, and I'm happy with the song overall. Solid 4 out of 5 for me. How about you?
I think we're basically on one line about this. Simple Life, I think, is a very good opening track. It sets the mood for the album really well. I do agree with you. I prefer the live versions, and especially the somewhat later live versions, because I'm sorry, I'm not too big a fan of Elton playing the digital piano. I just prefer to have him sit at a grand piano. I think that sound is just much fuller. And I always thought that his live era with a digital piano, with just a digital piano, because I know that he uses it on his racks still nowadays, but with just a digital piano, I just thought it was lacking the oomph that the piano should have in Elton John's songs. One small thing I disagree with you about is the length of the song. While most of it is very warranted, I do think that the one example that comes to mind is, of course, the Life in Barcelona version, where the song actually ends after the 3 oh yes. I think that works much better than having the bass and the drums then continue and those fade out. I do think towards the end, especially that very last piece of the outro, does drag the song a bit, but those are just a few seconds, and do they really make this song any less good? No, they don't. It's just a small nitpick, and overall, I'd say it's a solid 4 out of 5 as well.
Well, it's great that we're starting on somewhat the same page after such a long time doing this. But before I let you take over the next song, there's something you brought up that I forgot to mention. Thank you for that. This album is the last album, his last two albums, where it featured that digital piano, the Roland RD-1000, because the next studio album onwards, he switches over to a Disclavier. So, this is kind of like the end of the whole Roland era, so to say. So, yeah. And, you know, the thoughts about my thoughts on the Roland and stuff, not to nitpick it or to go into a tangent, but basically kind of what you, I kind of agree with what you said in general. I do like some of the sound effects it produces. Like, I think when it's used a certain way, it sounds great, but if you're talking strictly like as a piano, strictly using it as a piano and nothing else, you know, it's a little bit on the lackluster side because, you know, Elton's heavy hands don't come through on it. You know, he's got a heavy left hand, but it doesn't come through on the unit. And it just doesn't sound as good as an actual piano.
Yeah, yeah, it always sounds a bit thin. I agree with you when, for instance, on Philadelphia Freedom or in the jams at the end of Mona Lisa's and Mad Hatter's Part 2, the sound effects that they use are really good. But mm-hmm. when you hear him play the intro to Tiny Dancer on it, it's just... that song yeah. just needs a proper grand piano.
Yeah, or if you wanted to use that effect, I mean, if you were to combine like what he does nowadays, where he takes, you know, various racks and mixes them together, you know, that's something different. But you know, by itself, it yeah. as you said, I think it's kind of thin sounding and it doesn't have the meaty sound of a piano. But if you were to mix it, you know, with various other effects and different racks, and it sounds better, but by itself, I'm not a huge fan of it. But
yeah,
but, you know, that's a different subject. Go on with the one. You're next.
Thanks. So now, as Greg just revealed, we're moving on to the second track, which is the title track of the album, which is The One. Personally, I absolutely love this song. This is one of my favorites from Elton's. I think we're slowly entering the later days, so, and this is definitely one of my favorite tracks. Also, one that I love to hear live, and especially live with the band, which is we'll get to that in a minute. I think the song is a classic Elton track. The piano is prominent, has a clear hook. It was, as far as I know, it was a big hit. Around the world. It's one of the few Elton tracks that I actually hear regularly over here on Dutch radio, and I'm very pleased with that because I absolutely love this song. I just rate this song 5 out of 5. As for live versions, I am a big supporter of playing this song with the band. I just love those sweeping guitar sounds and those keyboard synths in the background. And I think it's a bit of a shame that, especially in recent years, it's been sort of been delegated to a just Elton and piano song. Whereas I think that especially the guitar solo towards the end just adds so much dimension, and the drums too, by the way, they just add so much dimension to this song. And I think it's a shame that it's not often performed that way. But anyways, that's my thought. My thoughts. A good 5 out of 5 song. Absolutely love it. Curious for your thoughts.
Well, for the one, I think it is one of the absolute best songs on the album, for sure. My second favorite track off of the album, because there's one other one on this album that I like just a little bit more, but this is still tops. So, you know, just because it's in second place doesn't mean it sucks or is really inferior. The One is a song that I do adore. I do consider it one of his best songs, not only of the album, but of the decade that he's done. You know, I do like it with the band, no doubt, but I also love it solo, too, because it's one of those things where, yeah, the band version and the solo piano version, two totally different takes on the song, but both offer up something excellent. As you said, on the band versions, you have the sweeping guitars, you have the great instrumental work, the great drumming. I mean, when it's played live with the band, you know, Charlie Morgan, phenomenal drummer, one of my personal favorite drummers, and, you know, he amazing dude too. And then, but just like, the band versions are amazing too, but I also love the solo ones because when you strip that song down to just Elton's voice and the piano, it brings out, you know, some hidden depths of that song. You know, you can hear Elton's great melodic piano work on it. Elton sings it extremely well in pretty much any incarnation, whether it be with band or with solo or the record. By the way, his record vocals throughout are very, very good on this record. The sobriety did him well, and he sounds excellent through this album, so we'll get that out of the way. Good singing by him, especially on this song. But yeah, I'm also a big fan of the solo versions, just because, you know, how Elton delivers it, and it kind of, you know, it gives the song kind of a more emotional, fragile edge to it, even though the band versions are fantastic in their own right, and you have all those different layers. It's one of those things where I don't have a preference really for band or solo. I just like to hear the song in general live. And to me, The One is a fantastic song overall. I will agree with you and give it a 5 out of 5. But I will put an asterisk by that because, and I will say this for most of the rest of the album, regardless of what I think about the songs, I think that the production on this album, at least for my ears, is a little bit overdone. I think there's a little bit too much cooks in the kitchen when it came to producing this. I think a lot of stuff would have benefited if it was stripped down a lot. But sometimes it ruins songs. Sometimes I can deal with it, but when I was going through this album, it made me think, man, if it was recorded like this, or if this wasn't here, I don't know. But to me, you know, the production on this album is a little bit too much for my tastes. I mean, I'm not gonna sit here and bitch and moan and say it's terrible, but because I know some people really like it the way it's produced, but it's not really for me. But regardless, The One is a fantastic song. Absolutely love it. 5 out of 5. Pretty much agree with you.
Yeah. I'm just going to cut in quickly because I don't want to clarify. I don't dislike his solo versions of The One. Absolutely not. It's just that the One has been across all recent shows that he's done, and I'm not talking the farewell tour because it's not in there, but I think he did it around 2014. I think even into 2016. And even though they were quote-unquote band shows, The One would be one of those tracks, like Candle in the Wind often is, where the band takes a breather and Elton just does it solo at the piano. There's nothing wrong with those versions. I just think it's a shame when it has such a good band arrangement as well. Why not use the band on the track?
Yeah, I mean, anyway. Yeah, there we go. I mean, I wasn't really getting the vibe where you were disliking the solo. I just thought you just love the band ones. You just love it. I'm like, well, you know, I'm just looking at it from both sides.
There's nothing wrong with
the band versions.
No. And there's nothing wrong with the solo versions
either.
That's
why I said equal but different qualities and stuff. So we'll go into the next song, Sweat It Out. Man, this you talking about getting punched in the face. The previous two songs, I really like or I loved. Sweat It Out, while it's got a good groove to it, and it's got some impressive instrumentation on it, namely Elton's piano solo. Man, it really loses me a little bit. I mean, I was sweating trying to think of something to say for the song, but it's just, I don't know. It comes off as like very like cluttered. Like it sounds like a mix of like New Jack Swing, which was really popular during this era, and like gospel and just, I mean it. I don't know, something about it, I don't know, something doesn't sound right about it. Like, it's not clicking for me. But, I mean, it has some good parts in it, though, but I never really got into it, and it does, and the Simple Life track and The One are 6-minute songs, 6.5-minute songs, but I can justify the length. Here, it's 6.5 minutes, but it's just, it goes on and on and on, and it's like, It's really long. I never really, this song hasn't clicked for me. Maybe you like this one, but I'm not really a big fan of it. But just because it has some good instrumentation in it, and I can hear effort put into being put into the song, but it's not really my cup of tea, I'm going to give it a 2 out of 5.
Well, I think that's a little harsh. I mean, this song, I'm just mostly indifferent to it, I guess. It's not it's not one of my favorite tracks on the album, but I don't hate it. I will agree with you that it drags, and it drags quite a bit. This is one of the songs that I'd say could use with some trimming. This is one of Elton's longest studio albums, you know, not counting the double records, and until CD came along to expand everything. I think this song could have used with some trimming, and I think that would have helped, because there is an okay-ish hook to it, and as you said, there's effort being put into it, but as it stands, it just goes on for too long. And usually when I'm listening to this album for fun, I listen to it till about the 3 minute, 3.5 minute mark, and then I just skip the rest of the song, because it just goes on for too long. Even, you know, usually when there's a piano solo in an Elton John song, I'm all for it, but even that in this song doesn't really do much for me, where it's okay, it's nice, it's there, and then it's over, and it leaves me feeling nothing. So 2 out of 5, I think, is maybe a bit harsh. I'm going to say 2.5 out of 5.
I'm overly harsh, and you rank it a half point higher than me. Okay. I guess I was a bit harsh on it.
Yeah, I didn't say you were overly harsh. I said a bit harsh. Let's not start spreading misinformation. You Americans have been doing that for quite a while now. Let's not go there.
I'm gonna plead the fifth on that one. Go ahead.
Thanks. We move on to track 4, which is a duet with Eric Clapton, and it's called "Runaway Train," which was also the second single released from the album. I like this song. I think it's fine. Do I think that it absolutely needed to be a duet? No, I think this song would have worked perfectly fine as a solo song as well. But I don't mind Eric Clapton being there, and it's a good song. I like the chorus. I'm not too big of a fan of the verses. I think they are overproduced, and they have too much things and sound effects going on in there. But once that chorus kicks in, I'm just grooving along to the song, and I'm enjoying myself, and it's all good for me. I'd say I'd rate the song a 3.5 out of 5.
3.5 out of 5. For me, I do quite like "Runaway Train." I think it's a good pop rocker with a bluesy rock edge to it. No doubt, because of Eric Clapton's guitar work. And what I just, you know, I like the feel of the song in general. Is it an absolutely amazing piece of work? Not especially, but I mean, considering everything, I think the grandiose production of the album actually kind of fits the song. So it sounds fine for this song, because it's kind of got that anthemic kind of a sound to it. And what I like is on live versions, if you listen to live versions of the song, you know, Eric Clapton would sometimes come on out and play the guitar with Elton. And I think that was a really cool touch. as far as the song is concerned in general, like on the record, everything, I think it's good. Not my absolute favorite track or anything, but it's a solid song, perfectly fine, and I think it's good. I would give it, kind of, it's right in between that, I like a little bit more than you, probably about 3 3/4, almost a 4, something about that. You know, it's about 1 star less than some other tracks that we've talked about in the past, but it's right up there. It's pretty good. But we'll get into the next song called Whitewash County. For me, this one was kind of a grower for me, because originally when I started hearing this, I just thought, it's kind of a killer filler. It's all right. But as I started to listen to it, I think it's quite a good song. It's pretty solid in general. I like Elton's vocals on it. And it's a grower. It was a grower song for me. It's not like something that I overly love, but it's something that it's quite good. I like it. I don't turn it off if it comes on, and I wouldn't skip it or anything. I think it's a good song. I'll give it about a 3.5 out of 5.
Oh, okay. I actually had the opposite effect with this song, where I started out really liking it, which is something that has happened to quite a bit of this album, where I really liked it upon initially listening to it, and as I listened to the album more and more, the production started to show itself more and more, and I started noticing more and more of its faults. And I must say, this song, I really like Elton's voice on it, and I like the melody of the song. But for some reason, as I've been listening to the song recently, the keyboard sound on the intro and the hook has been sounding really cheesy and sort of overproduced. And
that's why I said production.
yeah, and it's really sort of started bugging me recently. It's still a good song, and like I said, it's not that I dislike it. It's just, and actually, most of the song I still like. I love the chorus of this song, and it's actually a song that I like sort of singing along to. For those of you who know my singing, it's more like blaring along to, but it's a chorus I enjoy. But then when those keyboards kick in, I'm just like, damn it, Chris Thomas, what are you doing? So yeah, for me, this song is a 3 out of 5, I guess. It's okay, it's good. I enjoy it enough, but it has some faults. Then we move on to track number 6, The North. This song is one of my least favorites on the album, it sort of has a complicated reasoning behind it. It's because I think the lyrics are quite good. Elton's singing is quite good. The melody is all right. I don't think it's the strongest melody on the album, but it does have that sort of classic Elton edge to it, where the piano is very much in the forefront. And I think I could have liked this if it hadn't been for Chris Thomas and the production, because my God, there's so much layers upon layers upon layers of keyboards and sound effects and God knows what, cats screeching, dogs woofing, I don't know. But it just, this track feels like it could be a very subdued emotional track that works really well, and now it just feels empty, cold, overproduced, and with effects laden, which is such a shame, because I honestly do think that the work that Elton and Bernie did is fine, and then it could have been a great classic Elton track. And you know, he did this song live a few times, and I enjoyed the live performance so much more because it was so much more stripped down. But then when I get back to the studio album and I hear all those effects kicking in, it's just, I'm sorry. So I'm gonna give this song, because I see so much potential, I'm still going to give it a 2 out of 5, but that's really because I see the potential in there. And although that makes me even more infuriated at the fact that the production lets it down so badly, I do think I shouldn't rate it any lower, because that would be unfair to the material that is sort of there. Your turn.
My turn. Well, before I start talking about this, let me take care of something real quickly.
Oh, great. You couldn't have done that while I was talking?
No.
See, folks, this is the kind of attitude that I've had to work with. This is why we've been on a hiatus for 2.5 years.
Oh, don't spread misinformation.
Now, get a move on.
Well, the thing is, the North. Because I was thinking about what to say as you were expressing your points of view and me drinking, you know, so I can, you know, cure my sore throat and everything. But I don't disagree with a single thing you just said in the last couple minutes, because I am aware of the live versions that Elton did on his 93 tour with Ray, and they sound amazing. You know, it sounds like a classic emotional Elton ballad, and he sounds awesome on it, and it's just structured so well. It's a great song. This version in the studio does not do this song any favors. I have no idea why it was written like that. It's like, this is almost reminiscent of some of the things on Leather Jackets, where you have these potentially great songs, not everything, but there's some songs on there that are great songs, but the production kills it because of, you know, overproduction or certain instruments used or the way it's set up here. It's like, if Elton just did it as a piano ballad with nothing else on it, like if it was in the studio, just like the live versions, or if it was like the last song or something where it's like minimal production, it would have been a bona fide Elton classic and just amazing. But it's like this beautiful song getting wrecked in the studio with this production just grinds my gears to no end. I have never felt anything like that leading up to this album and the songs. I mean, there are songs where I would say, well, the production kind of does not necessarily ruin it, but kind of drags it a bit, but it's a good song. I've had that before, but here it's like, I've never been so angry listening to a song where it's such an amazing song because I've heard it stripped down, and then to hear the studio overproduction butchery done to it just grinds my gears. I've never felt so angry listening to a record version of a song. I don't know what I would rank it because the song itself, I would give it like a 4 to a 4.25 out of 5. The production is awful on the record. But I can't give the song a 1 or a 2 because that's not fair. As you said earlier, that's not doing it justice. It's like I could meet in the middle and just say like a 3 and then put an asterisk by it and explain that this is actually a highly excellent song that's ruined by the production. But I don't know. I feel very conflicted talking about that song. And it's something I've never felt before talking about songs on a review. Because I've never felt conflicted like that, where I don't know what to rank a song. I mean, and it's not like a difference of a quarter of a star or half a star. It's like a song that's so good, ruined by production, that drags the ranking down. But yet, if I rank it down here, it's doing it injustice to the song.
I know, man. I know. I had the same issue.
It's making my eyes water thinking about it, and it's making my nose run thinking about it. It's making my blood pressure go up. But by default, I'll just give it a 3. And I had to stress that it's a great song. It's a great song that could have been at least at the bare minimum a 4, maybe a 4.5, but the production fucking ruined it. I've never been so angry. So I'll give it a 3. Is that okay? Are you going to chastise me for that?
No, I can kind of see where you're coming from, and I had the same issue, so I can hardly chastise you for something that I've been going through as well. So just move on to the next song, and quit whining.
Thank you for that. The next song is When a Woman Doesn't Want You. I can speak from experience. But yeah, it's sort of a blend of, you know, R&B and country. For me, this song is, again, I kind of want to go back to some things I said on the song Sweat It Out. I can hear that there's effort in this song. Like, I can tell that, you know, after Elton got out of rehab and they were working on this, I can tell they were inspired. There's effort involved on this. They're trying their best, you know. So I can hear the effort done on this. But for some reason, this song is, again, it's not clicking with me. It's not. It's a filler track. I'm not the biggest fan of it in general. But I mean, I'll listen to it and deal with it. But it's one of those things where it's not. For me, it's not the song for me. The production again is, you know, not to my liking, and it just drags. So I understand. I get the effort. I know there's effort on this, and again, Elton sounds great, but just because there's effort and he sounds great doesn't make it into a good song. And I don't really think it's that too great of a song in general. I don't know. I'll give it probably about 1.75 to a 2. So it is pretty low. So far, this is probably my least favorite track so far. Go ahead.
Fascinating. This is our first big disagreement, I think, because I quite like this song. I will once again stress that the production doesn't do it any favors, and there are definitely parts of it that I don't like. But, well, once again, it's also a song written in 6/8 time signature, and I'm just... Dear Lord, what is wrong with your eyes?
Go ahead.
Anyway, but I quite like this song and I like the feel of it. Do I think it's a masterpiece? No. Do I think it's a decent song? Yes. I definitely don't think this is the worst song on the album. Strictly looking at end results, so how the songs came out on the album, I'm so sorry. I know there's a good song in there, but The North would even rank lower than this song for me, because contrary to The North, the production does work in some ways for this song. Once again, do I think it's a great song? No, definitely not. But it's a song that I like bobbing my head to. I don't mind it too much, and I'd give it a 3 out of 5.
Go ahead.
Right, then we come to Emily. Once again, Chris Thomas, what are you doing? This is not The North, where there's a classic Elton song hidden somewhere deep down and the production slaughters it. But this could have been a good song, like a solid album track, and just the production comes in with all the poo-ha and everything, and no. I actually like the choruses. I like the verses, and I like the instrumental break in there. I think the piano keyboard solo that happens in the middle of the song is absolutely beautiful. The chorus I'm not too big a fan of, but that's just personal taste. But the production, once again, does such a disservice to this track. There's once again, so many keyboard sounds and sound effects layered in there that are just not necessary. And it's such a shame. I'd say this song could have definitely been, for me, a 4 out of 5. But the way it sounds right now, 3.5 out of 5 at best.
Oh. You know, this is rather strange, because you know, we had our little disagreement on when a woman doesn't want you. But here it's like I'm sorry, but I kind of feel the same way as not only what you said, but also kind of echoing thoughts about The North. I mean, first of all, I don't think it's as good as The North in general. But as you said, I think it could have been a good song. Almost a classic, or at the very least, a classic Elton ballad. And I love my Elton ballads. Don't get me wrong. He's great at Elton ballads. I think, you know, he's phenomenal. But if you take such a good song and you destroy it with effects and overproduction and gimmicks, it doesn't work. Too many cooks in the kitchen. It doesn't work. It's like, you know, let the song speak for itself. Let it breathe. You know, swamping things and effects and multi-instruments does not aid a song. I'm sorry. I mean, it's like, you know, on a different tangent with Iron Maiden, having 20-minute long songs that go absolutely nowhere and in multiple parts doesn't make them good. But it's like, as you said, I think this could have been a good song, a solid 3.5. But no, I think it's ruined by, again, the needless overproduction. And yeah, that's my one big complaint about this album. If I were to take the songs out of the equation, it's the production that just kills me about this, because, you know, even if I like a song on the album, it's like, it could have sounded better if it sounded like this. Oh, it's like I listen to this album and I'm like, I shouldn't feel angry listening to an album. You know, especially if it's songs that are good, that could have been great if it weren't for so-and-so. And unfortunately, this is what I've been getting on this record. And I've never felt like that a lot of times. I'm not counting stuff like Leather Jackets, because even despite the Monsters production, there's shit songs, and the Monsters production probably aided that. But here, it's like, there are great songs on this album that could have been classics, or at the very least, semi-classic songs that are high quality, but the production just, it makes my eyes water. It's like, let the song speak for itself. Don't bury it in layers of synthesizers and effects and wall of sound stuff and echo and reverb. You know, don't do that. Let the song speak for itself. Emily could have been a great song. 3.5, maybe pushing a 4 if I was feeling generous, but I ain't feeling generous. I'm feeling vindictive right now. 2.5 out of 5. And I'm not saying that because the song is 2.5. It's that goddamn production that drags it. So, man, if I were to go through these rankings, I'm putting asterisks on some of them. Because if I were to take the production out of it, you know, some of these songs would be at least a star higher. I can guarantee you that.
I think we found a common enemy, my friend.
Yeah, look, because here's the thing. We don't see eye to eye on a lot of things, but here's the thing. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. My enemy right now is that goddamn production. So maybe if we can stop bitching at each other like an old married couple, you know, and focus on their production antics, we can take care of business.
Right, so move on to the next song.
Oh, you got it. You got it. And you got me in such a rage right now, I'm putting my eyeglasses on so I can see what the fuck I'm doing. Because my vision's blurred right now. On Dark Street is the next song. Okay. Again, the monstrous production doesn't do it any favors. But unlike some of the other tracks, even if the production wasn't an issue, I'm still not really a big fan of the song in general. I think it's a poor rewrite of Healing Hands. And I'm not a fan of it. And it comes off as really fillery. Don't like it in particular at all. Production aside, it's pretty weak. Is it the worst abomination of a song? No. I can think of other songs from earlier albums that are way worse. Namely, a certain album from 1979. Some songs from 86. But this one is low on my list. 1.5 out of 5. Don't like it. Didn't get into it. It hasn't grown on me. Maybe after I hear you rant and rave and bitch me out, maybe I'll think twice about saying my rankings, but not a fan of it. Go ahead.
Interesting. I disagree with some points you said there. I think the production overall on this album is bad, but this song doesn't get hurt too bad by it because it's quite a bombastic song, so the bombastic production sort of fits the song, and much like some earlier tracks on this album, do I think it's a masterpiece? Absolutely not. Do I think it's a fun song that I like bobbing my head to? Absolutely yes. I like the sort of brass sounds that are in there. I don't think the song is overproduced. I think it sounds all right the way it is. I don't quite see the comparison with Healing Hands. If I'm honest, I think they're two very separate songs. There's actually another song by a different artist that this reminds me very much of, and that I somehow always get confused. And yes, the other artist's version is better. But do I think this is bad? Nah, it's okay. It's decent. I like bobbing my head to it. It's, I'm gonna say it's a 3 out of 5.
You like it twice as much as me.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. I will deal with it. And I will go to therapy and explain to my counselor about the pent-up anger inside of me. But I'm not here to talk about my personal problems or my mental health issues. Please go on.
I will. I might even piss you off even more, because this next song is my personal least favorite song on the album. Like you've said in previous songs, you can hear the effort. I can even hear that it's a fine song. Am I a fan of it? No. Do I like listening to it? No. This is actually the track that I usually skip on this album. This song doesn't do it for me, and it's not because it's a bad song, it's just because it's not to my taste. We've had the similar thing happen on Sleeping with the Past. This is just not up my alley. I can hear the effort, I can hear it's an okay song, but it's just not for me. It's not something I like listening to. I listened to it a few more times for this review, but my opinion on it hasn't changed. It's still one of my least favorite songs on the album. Actually, it's my least favorite song on the album, and because I can hear it's a good song, it's just a matter of taste, I'm gonna give it 2 out of 5. But nah, this is just not for me. Sorry.
It's not for you. The song isn't for you.
Yep.
Is that what you said? The song is not for you?
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. I don't understand women either, so it's not for me either. For me, this song is, yeah, definitely weak. Is it the weakest track on the album? Potentially. There was another song I think it ties for as the worst track, at least for me on the album. I will say, though, it has David Gilmour from Pink Floyd playing guitar on it. So there's one positive, I suppose.
No, hold on. That doesn't make any sense. By that logic, Ange Lied on Leather Jackets should be a positive, or should have a positive, because Roger Taylor and John Deacon are on there. And that's still utter shite. So let's not pretend that just because it has a guest star on it, that's a positive.
Well, here's the thing. Angeline's its own animal. This is a completely different animal. Understanding women, yeah. It has David Gilmour. I suppose if you like his playing, it's a positive. But I don't know. The song isn't for me. I never liked it. It's just, I don't even think it's a good song that's, destroyed by bad production. I think it's a weak song that, the production does a weak song no favors. I mean, it's like, David Gilmour plays guitar, whoop-de-doo. And, Kiki D is on the backing vocals. Yay, I suppose. And yeah, I mean, Nigel's on backing vocals on a couple tracks on this album. Kiki D is. That's great. But it doesn't help the songs. It's just, I don't get it. I don't get it. It's just, like you said, the song has effort in it, but it's not clicking. I mean, maybe someone else loves this song and they could probably tell me why they like it, so I could get educated about it. But it's not for me. To me, it's right down there with the worst songs on the album. I'll give it the same ranking as the previous song, on Dark Street, 1.5 out of 5. I never liked it. It isn't for me. But I am so glad that we're at the end of the album. Because after a series of songs that I either don't like or the production does it no favors or any combination of both, we finally get to the last song on the main album, a.k.a. the last song, no pun intended. Thank fucking Christ. What a relief to hear this song. And I'm not even going to mention the production because it doesn't hurt this song. Although I have my things about the live versions, you know, I like listening to those. But to me, the last song is the best song off of this album. I think it's one of Elton's most beautiful ballads. A very emotional track. Subject matter, you know, about AIDS. It's a very deep track, and it's an amazing song. It is my favorite track off this album. And I love hearing it. I don't get tired of it. I listen to it in all forms. Record, band live, solo live. I think it's a fantastic song. And I think it's wonderful. One of Elton's best songs, not only of the album and the 90s decades, but I would go so far as to say if I were to build a list of my all-time favorite Elton songs, I would probably put it in my top 20 to 25 Elton songs of all time. So, yeah, absolutely love it. No faults, 5 out of 5. And I absolutely love it. Never get tired of it. Go ahead.
The last song. And that introduction probably made a lot of people very anxious. Don't get me wrong, I love this song. I think it's one of Elton's most emotional songs. I think it's a perfect song, beautiful. Love the live versions. But this entire album, Elton's voice has had a sort of reverb on it. It's more obvious on some songs than this on others. And in some songs it works, like the more bombastic tracks, Simple Life, The One. Those tracks all sort of benefit from that sort of production. But the production just, it doesn't murder the song. This is not a case of the North where it's overproduced or anything. But just thinking of how this could have sounded if they'd have done this in a, what I'd like to call, a natural way. Just Elton at a proper grand piano, because I'm sorry, but this is the one song that also really bothers me, that he's playing a digital piano where it's not the full piano sound, and then that slight reverb on his vocals. It just, this would have without a doubt been my favorite track if not for those nitpicks. They just do it such injustice. I love the live versions where he's playing a grand piano. I'm not too big of a fan of the digital piano live versions, because I usually find that the crowd noise, even makes the digital piano sound even worse, because it's not strong enough to break through the crowd noise like a normal grand piano is. But when I listen to versions like, in, I think it's 1994 that I've heard versions of this song, and I just love the way that song sounds like that. And then when I listen to this with the digital piano and the voice effect, it's such a shame. I'm gonna give this song 4 3/4. And that's not because I think this song doesn't deserve the 5 out of 5, but just because the production still doesn't do any justice. Give me a live version of this song and I will happily rate it 6 out of 5. It's a brilliant song. It's an emotional song. A live version has me in tears. But this version just... the effects kill it. And it takes away... This is a song that should have intimacy, where you almost feel like you're sitting next to Elton on the piano bench and he's singing it just for you. And the effects make it sound as if he's in a concert hall and he's on stage and you're all the way up in the balcony. And it's such a shame because this song should have that intimacy, that feeling of, like they said, this is a song from a father to his son, so this should be intimate. They should be small, they should be quiet and not have reverb and some shitty digital piano. That just, no, I'm sorry, but that's my final judgment.
4 3/4.
Yeah, I know. I'm gonna get a lot of hate for that, but what? I will stand by it. Chris Thomas, you shouldn't have produced this album. You should have stopped after having your run in 1989.
4 3/4.
Yeah. And that's just because of the production, not because of the song, not because of Elton's performance, nothing, just the damn bloody production.
4 3/4. That ranking is very familiar, but yeah, I get it. Okay, this ends the main album. And as you can see, you know, we have our differences on some songs, but surprisingly, we don't seem to be going off the same page too often. In fact, there are some things we actually agree on quite a bit about this record.
Yeah.
I was expecting something different, but then again, after 2.5 years of not doing things... I don't know what to suspect. but yeah, as I said earlier, there were 4 singles released from this album. The one was released about a month before the album came out. Runaway Train was the second single released a month after the album came out. Last Song was released in late October, and Simple Life was in May of 93. I will give credit, at least they pick great fucking songs off this album to promote it. They pick 4 strong songs. As you can hear, if you go back, we all gave favorable to great reviews for those 4 songs.
Yep.
So good choice on the singles. That's a strong suit. They picked the right songs. Because God forbid if they picked some of those other ones, oh, my teeth would be cracked from clenching my jaw. But yeah, so, you know, we talked about the main album, but that's not all. Because on the 1998 reissue, there are 2 bonus tracks. And these were the B-sides to the one single. Depending on where you were at and what type of single you got, it was either Suit of Wolves or Fat Boys and Ugly Girls.
Go there, you're forgetting something, which is we usually, after finishing the main album, we give our thoughts on said album, and then we move on to the bonus tracks.
Well, here's the thing. I'm older, so yeah, my memory's a little bit fucking faulty. I'm sorry. I haven't done this in 2.5 years. Still a little rusty. You're younger than me, so everything works better. So thank you for stepping up to the plate and reminding me that I fucked up and I need to go back and fix that. So, since you're so keen and enthusiastic about that, you start. Why don't you give your final thoughts and opinions on the album and an overall star ranking? Go first.
All right. So my overall thoughts on the one is it's a good album. It could have been a great album, but as it stands, it's a good album. It has a fair amount of good tracks, and I think as a whole piece of work, most of it works. As I said, there's one track that I always skip over. The rest of the tracks I usually listen to when listening to this album. So I it's a good album. But Chris Thomas should definitely be arrested because he ruined what could have been an awesome album. This with just switching out one track and a better production, this could have been one hell of an album. And just because of all the overproduction, like I just said, most of the more bombastic songs are fine, but Chris Thomas just doesn't know, at least at this time, he didn't know how to produce a simple track. Everything had to have layers and layers and layers of effects and synthesizers and whatever. And for some songs that works, but some songs get absolutely massacred, and it's such a shame. Once again, this could have been an awesome album, but as it stands, it's a good one. Overall rating, I guess I'll give it a 3.5 out of 5.
yeah, I mean, as you said, my thoughts about this, again, angry. That's all I can say. I'm so angry listening to this album because I exactly what you just said. It could have been an amazing comeback album. You know, Elton's first studio album after achieving sobriety. And it could have been an amazing comeback album. And it had all the potential to be a great, to even an excellent record. But the production just killed it for me. There are some great songs on this album. Don't get me wrong. The last song, The One, some of my all-time favorite Elton songs from the 90s decade and of all time. Simple Life, a great opener. Runaway Train is a very solid duet song. Whitewash County is fair. The North could have been a classic, but, you know, but so conflicted and so angry when I listened to this album because it could have been so good. So my thing about it is it's a mixed bag album for me, but it had the potential to be awesome. If the production was less bombastic on a lot of tracks, as you said, and if they, at least in my eyes, took one or two of the tracks off the record, then it would have been better. But, yeah, it's a mixed bag album, but a lot of that is not Elton's fault at all, because there's some great songs on this record, but the final results, too many cooks in the kitchen, production completely overboard.
You keep saying too many cooks in the kitchen. That only applies if there's multiple people working on something and they all disagree in which direction it should go and they sort of stretch a project thing. That's not what's been happening here.
I think it is, because if you're putting an effect here and an effect here, there's too many pieces of crap going on ruining records. And
yeah, but that's not too many cooks in the kitchen. That would have been if there'd been six producers and they all wanted different effects. This is one producer layering effect upon effect upon effect.
Yeah, well, I think the producer sent his cooks, you know, to butcher the songs and, you know, throw them in the oven and look what we got. So
I'm not sure you understand what cooking is. You don't put cooks in the oven to prepare your food. The cook prepares the food and puts the food in the oven.
Well, you know, I really need to actually watch more of Kitchen Nightmares properly then. But in either case, the production ruined the album.
That's true.
And yeah, it could have been classic. It's just too many bad decisions, you know, with this production, and like it's too much. It's too much for me. If the album was more stripped down, if it was like the next studio album in terms of that production, then I would have ranked it a whole lot better. But unfortunately, you know, it's not that record. This record has its flaws, and those flaws really bring it down. As far as how I would rank it, I would probably say, you know, yeah, 3.5 sounds about fair. I may bump it up to 3.75 just because of the potential of a couple songs that could have been amazing, but the production ruined it. Just because somebody was having too much fun with the effects. But it's just, oh, as I said, when I listen to this album, I should not feel conflicted and angry listening to an album. unless that's what the artist wants. And I don't think Elton wanted us to listen to The One and be angry and conflicted. At least I don't think so.
No, I agree. I don't
No.
think he'd want this either.
No.
So now we can move on to the bonus tracks.
Good. And then since you want to start, you go ahead.
No, you start. You were the one who was so anxious to get to the bonus tracks, so you start.
No, that was me making a mistake. But the thing is, I realized I screwed up at the way beginning of the review. Because on the previous review we did 2.5 years ago, Sleeping with the Past, I started that review. I accidentally started this one. So, in me being kind and the kind aged wizard that I am, I'm going to let you start the bonus tracks.
Well, you can take that kindness and shove it where the sun don't shine because you're gonna start us off.
All right, I'm out of here. No, okay. Oh, you're making me so angry. I got snot coming out of my nose now. So thank you for tapping into my emotions, and thank you for giving me a, you know, piece of your mind throughout this whole review, and thanks for, you know, making me so unstable. I highly appreciate your kindness.
Well, you just get to the bonus tracks.
Okay, Suit of Wolves. This was the B-side to the one single, the 7-inch version, and it was also apparently on some of the CD editions too. Suit of Wolves to me is a throwaway track. I don't overly care for it in general. When I was listening to it and kind of reading some comments about it, there were some people who really like it and wish it was on the actual album. But to me, it's a throwaway track. You know, nothing. I mean, I'm not going to say it's terrible. I mean, it's not the worst thing, but it's a throwaway. It is what it is. Not a huge fan of it. I don't know, probably 2 stars at the very most, and that's being generous.
I see. Well, I will agree with you that it's not a masterpiece. It's not a great song. But 2 stars out of 5, nah. This deserves a little more. I like Suit of Wolves. It's a good enough track. It suffers from the same bane that every song on this album has, which is it's overproduced. It sounds thin, it sounds distant, and it sounds a little empty. It's good enough. I like it as a B-side. It does its job as a B-side. Do I think it should have been placed on the album? Maybe instead of Understanding Women, but that's more because I dislike that track so much. than that it is because this track is so good. Overall, I enjoy it well enough, and I'm gonna give it a 3 out of 5. The other bonus track on this release was Fat Boys and Ugly Girls. I like this track more than Suit of Wolves. It has a boppy, almost cheesy feel to it. It always makes me finish the reissue with a smile. I like bopping my head to it. The lyrics aren't the best, but it's fun. It's not a masterpiece, but it's fun, and I like it. I think it's better than Suit of Wolves. This is the track that I'd actually switch Understanding Women with. If this track had been on the album instead of that one, I would have been happier with the album. Would it have salvaged the album? No, because once again, this track suffers from the same production issues as the other ones do. But I like it, and I'm gonna give it 3 3/4. There you go.
Fat Boys, Ugly Girls. Well, the title is a bit humorous. The song itself is actually quite nice. It is very upbeat. It's a light song. It kind of gives me a little bit of a throwback vibe. It kind of has, you know, a little bit of an old school soul throwback to it, albeit with, you know, in the early 90s. The production is still there, but it doesn't bother me as much on this track as it does on some of the other ones. I do think this should have been on the album because it is stronger than quite a few of the tracks. Now, make no mistake, it ain't a masterpiece. I'll steal that from you. But it's not offensive. It's fine for what it is. I'd gladly, you know, would take off. You know, I would switch this out for Understanding Women and, you know, On Dark Street. So, I mean, I would be fine with that on the album. Overall ranking, you know, it's decent. It's all right. 3.5 out of 5.
All right. And that's it. That's the end of this review. I guess we finished all the tracks. We finished the album, our overall thoughts.
Oh, absolutely. And here's the thing. You know, I'm surprised that we weren't at each other's throats as much as I thought.
Well, I think that might happen next time, because the next album that's coming up is a very mixed bag, and I think it's going to be very interesting what we think of each individual track, because let's be honest, there is almost no cohesion there.
Yeah, because when I was thinking about it, when I was thinking about one of the statements that I made earlier about the production, when I said, you know, the next studio album, I had the
next solo album, yeah, probably.
Yeah, and then I realized, oh shit, hopefully it's not what I was thinking, you know, because I was thinking the solo album, and I totally forgot there was something sandwiched in between those two. And I'm like, and I realized, oh, whatever. So,
so you goofed yourself pretty bad there.
Yeah, cause, yeah, you can see how much I care about that. But yeah, we will be back sometime in the near future. Now, I want to stress to all of my personal fans and subscribers out there that we will not take 2.5 years ever.
Probably.
We will not do that, because here's the thing. You know, I've cleared my schedule out. You know, I've made sure things are going well on my end. You know, I have turned down job offers so I could do this show with Stan, because I'm loyal to the show. And, you know, I just, you know, The thing is, I don't want to do a show like this with anybody else, because that's not fair. And plus, you know, Stan has told me via messages that if I did a show with anybody else in this format, he would come over and inflict some serious physical harm on myself. So it's best if I do not do a show with anybody else.
Yes, I think that would be best for both of us.
That's right, because if I ever catch you going off and doing an Elton John album review show with somebody else, the consequences will be dire. I will not reveal what will happen, but rest assured, it will not be pretty.
Well, and on that lovely note, I think that will be a perfect time to wrap up this video. Greg, despite everything, I'd have to say, this has been fun.
Absolutely.
It's great to be back in the saddle, and we'll see you guys soon. I promise. Absolutely. I'll drag him in front of the screen if I have to.
Hey, I will make sure you show up next time on time. So there you go.
You were the one who was half an hour late.
Oh, I had my reasons, but I sat in this chair without walking onto camera, so give me some sort of credit.
No.
Okay.
We'll see you guys next time.
It's not fucking stopping.
Everything on my hand and is fine so far.
Yes, everything on your hand is good. Okay. All right.